My wife was off her feet for a couple of weeks with foot surgery, so she decided to make some needlework panels, and you know, it came time to make some frames for them. So I just thought that I'd just make a video showing you how I made some quick, simple frames for her needlework that she did. I started with some poplar, and this I had harvested from in my backyard years ago, and I figured I'd use a light wood that you know, wouldn't stain or show through too bad. So I had already, you know, planed this at one point, but I needed a little bit thinner, so I ran it through my planer and you know, got it to the correct thickness that I wanted. Then I went back and had to joint the edges to, you know, make them perpendicular to the flat faces, and you know, get them ready to cut up into strips for the frames. Actually, the frames were two parts, and this is the first part of the frame. It's the inner frames that I will be stretching the all the needle points around. Now, they were done on like a muslin cloth that, you know, and that is what I'll be mounting to these frames first. So there's all the strips all cut up, and so now it was just time to take the miter gauge on my saw there and, you know, start putting the angles on it, cutting the parts to the correct length for the glue up. So this, you know, I'm pretty happy now that I've made all these modifications to my grizzly saw to collect the dust, because I seem not to be getting any dust in the air anymore. So, you know, it's really helped out. I still get some dust escaping, but that's all right. And then here it is. I just put a stop block on the miter gauge here, and I just set that up for the correct length so I could cut all my frame pieces to match. Now, actually, she did six of them at this point in time, but I'm making enough parts here to make 10 frames, because there may be a couple more added in the future. So I figured, you know, while I'm doing a rough setup and cutting, I just cut the parts to start out. So there's all the pieces for the inner frame, and I went over to that little clamp board that I made up that uses my router clamps I designed and built a while ago. And that makes, you know, squaring up and gluing up little frames really easy to do. So, you know, like I do with all my projects, I use that that Tight Bond 3. It seems to be a pretty good glue for, you know, holding things together, and it's what I have laying around, so that's what I use. So I just kind of spread that evenly on all the surfaces that mate. And then this, you know, this clamping board makes it really easy, because you just push it up against the two square corners there. Then I put the other slide clamps in, and then a couple of those rubber band cam clamps to hold everything together. And, you know, a couple minutes later, it's set up enough to remove. And then there's those marks I get from that planer that I bought. I tell you what, they're pretty nasty in softwoods, as you can see there, and they show up in all your work. So a pain in the neck to sand out. So I guess I wouldn't recommend the grizzly planers like I bought. So then I just went back and threw a couple of those little pin nails in the corners, just to add a little bit of extra strength. Just, you know, when I stretched the material over it, I was just hoping that it would, you know, help if it got any racking or anything. And then it was time to go back and try to sand all those marks off and, you know, sand all the corners flush and get rid of all the glue. So, you know, that's just standard procedure. And then I decided that on the inside of these frames, I was going to put a radius around there, just so that the material wouldn't get hung up and, you know, caught up or anything on there over time. And, you know, hopefully to keep a sharp corner from showing through at a later point in time, too. So, I just use those same clamping board for just about everything anymore, it seems like. And, you know, just use it to hold stuff while I'm working on it. And, you know, it seems to work pretty good for, you know, what I'm doing with it. So, you know, here I just put the little radiuses around the inside just to, you know, break the edge. And then I went over to my router cable and set up a couple of stops and a bit, just to cut a little undercut in the bottom of the frame that I would be using for a screw to hang it. Now, I really didn't have to cut four of them in there. I only really needed one at the top. But somehow, whenever I try to cut just one, I always wind up with that, you know, that point being not at the top and being on the side or the bottom. So I figured, you know, while I'm set up, I might as well just cut them all like that. It only takes a second. So, you know, with that frame all done, basically, it was just a little bit of, I went back and put a couple coats of clear polyurethane on there just so that no stains would come through in the future. And, you know, there they are, the first six of the inner frames all ready to go. And, I mean, like I said, they're nothing fancy, but they'll work. And then I took a piece of walnut that I had harvested from my backyard, and it was a little warped and bowed and too big to fit on my joiner, so I had to actually cut it in half so I could, you know, go through and flatten it good before I ran it through the planer, so I would have nice flat pieces in the end. Now, with the planer, I just like to just set it to take maybe a 16th of an inch off at a time when I have a warp board like this. It seems to help relieve the stress and everything else by, you know, not taking too much at one cut. So I'd rather take a couple of thinner cuts and wind up with a real nice flat board in the end. And you have to make sure that you do not push down on the boat area. You have to let that just, you know, work its way out and machine itself out so you wind up with a real flat board in the end. And then after, flattening it, I just went through and took it to the joiner and ran a perpendicular edge onto it. And then back over to the grizzly planer that, as you'll see in a little while, is going to emboss nice grooves across this real nice walnut as it planes it. And from the sounds of it, that's the way it works, and there's nothing that can be done about it. So I guess I wouldn't recommend this planer. I would never buy it again, at least. So, here we are just planing the thickness of the wood now. It's just funny how the spiral cutter head does such a nice smooth finish on it, but that outfeed roller, there it is, just embosses the little grooves in it, and, you know, it makes it a lot of sanding and stuff. Now that I got that the right thickness, it's time to take that cover off the table saw and go back and start cutting these strips up to the correct width for the outer frame that's going to go around the needle points. Now, it's just going to be a little narrow frame with a rabbet on it, and this outer frame is made with a little bit of clearance to go around the needle point, so there's room for the corners to fold in and whatnot. I'm kind of hoping that friction will hold it in place when I'm done, but, you know, we'll see about that later. So you know, here it is, just, you know, cutting all the strips up to the proper width. And, you know, cuts like this I don't really like doing because you can't use the guard on the table saw. There's really not enough clearance to get it in there. So you have to be real careful when you get in a situation like this. So there they are, all just, you know, all the strips are just ripped to width now. And so now I decided to just go back and, you know, cut them a little bit over length to a rough length so that I could do the next step of putting a rabbet in. I originally had thought about using the full length pieces to rabbet, but just thought it would be easier to make them, you know, a little bit shorter to deal with and to get a good job when you run it through the saw. Okay, so there's the, the six sets of where they're going to go. There's the marks in the walnut, too. I mean, you can see that's what you can expect from the grizzly planers with that sharp serrated outfeed roller that they have. And then, you know, I just went back here and instead of using a router or anything, I just decided to make two cuts with the table saw to put the little rabbet in there. And I wanted to overcut it a little bit anyway, so there'd be room if there was you know, any material that was gathered in the corner or anything that didn't quite fit right. And I mean, as you can see, I used that little feather board that I got from Grizzly to, you know, kind of help hold everything in place, keep it from slipping. And then I just, you know, for pushing it through for the second cut, I had an oversized push stick that allowed the blade to just cut through it and push that piece of waste out so it wouldn't come, you know, flying back or kick back or anything. I mean, it's, you know, this took a little while to do, but, you know, it wasn't that bad. It was fairly easy. And, you know, as you can see, I've been having pretty good luck with the dust collection on the saw with all those modifications. Then I just went back to the miter gauge and I actually clamped some stops on and a couple of extra pieces to help keep everything square and, you know, from sliding or rotating when I cut them, because there, you know, actually was a rabbit missing out of one corner of them now. So this really helped to ensure that you got a perfect cut so that you could, you know, glue them up with no bad spots. The first I cut, you know, all on one side, and then I went back and reset the stop block to the final length, which would leave me maybe about 3/16 of clearance around the other frame for the fabric to wrap around. That is just another boring job of, you know, going through and just taking my time and cutting all the parts to the correct length with the 45 miter on the end of them for glue up. And there's all the parts, they're all cut, and you know, basically back over to that little clamp board that I use, you know, quite often for frames and stuff like that. It really makes stuff like this, you know, glue ups go really quick, and everything is perfectly square when you're done. So it's been a real handy little thing. So there they are, just you know, all glued up, and that's the way they're going to go together. There's just a rabbit in the back of the walnut frame, and that just kind of sits over the other one. Now it's time to do some sanding, and I always use that fan with some filters on, especially with walnut. Walnut's a really nasty sawdust to breathe in, and you don't want to be breathing any of it. So what I do is I just set that fan up on high and pull it everything through the filter, which, you know, really does keep the shop air pretty much free of sawdust. So there they are, all done. Now it's ready to just basically throw a coat of finish on them. Now before I finish them, I want to be able to, you know, finish both sides and not have to worry about it, mess around with them. So what I usually do is I take that little brad pusher that I've got, and I just take some, I think they're 1 inch by like 18 gauge brads, and just push them in a little bit on the back side to help elevate the frame so that you can, you know, paint both sides of it. And then you just pull them out later, and, you know, there'll be a couple little marks in the back, but it's on the back so nobody's going to see it. So next I went to, and I just put 2 coats of clear polyurethane on here, the water-based stuff. I did 1 coat, and I sanded it good, and then I went back and did another coat, and, you know, let it dry for a couple hours. And then I just go back with some steel wool and Johnson's paste wax to go back over, and that really helps take all the final brush marks out of the polyurethane, which for some reason I always seem to get them in the that water-based polyurethane. Now with the parts all made, it's really time just to go back and start mounting all the needle points on the frames. And for that, I'm using this little Harbor Freight stapler. I don't know, I bought it years ago for some upholstery work, and I really enjoyed using it for stuff like this. Only thing you want to do is make sure that you do not put any oil in it when you use it for this. I don't know how long it's going to last using it oilless, but, you know, for a couple of years, it's been working good for me. So I have no real complaints for it. I think I paid about $8 with a coupon for it. So it's really handy. Only trouble is there's no safety on it, and I have gotten a staple stuck in my leg just by grabbing it by the trigger one time and not really paying attention. So there is no safety, and you really have to be careful. So the first thing I decided to try and do is tape down one side of the first needle point there. Just kind of keep everything stretched so it would stretch straight when I went to put it on the frame. Then I centered everything on the frame and, you know, just basically tacked it in with three staples, one in the center, and then just kind of one towards each edge there a little bit, as you can see. And when I got done with this, you'll see I wasn't really happy with what I had done, because I had to go back and pull the staples out because I had not left any room for stretching. Turned out if I went to pull the other side over, it actually shifted the pattern by about an eighth inch when the material stretched. So I had to go back through, and you know, here I am. I shifted the frame over the needlework by about a 16th of an inch off center. And that seemed to work out really good for when I pulled the other side and stretched it now. So I got the first side done there. And then I went back and, you know, I had to... There you can see how it kind of stretches out by about an eighth inch when you pull it. So that's why I had to shift the pattern originally. And then I just went back and I did the same thing. And actually, I just pulled a little bit towards the top and the bottom to kind of stretch it evenly too in the other direction as I was going. And so this would give me a good start for, you know, trying to get the wrinkles out. Okay, so there it is, the first side stretch. Then I just went back and did the same thing. And that tape really did help to keep everything from deforming. It kept the, you know, the needlework really straight, didn't pull it out of shape or anything by using that. So I did the same thing on the on, you know, this is the bottom here, and I just kind of did it with three staples to get started and get everything kind of pulled out, the wrinkles pulled out where I could. And then it was just a matter of you know, turning it over and just kind of stretching that top side. Now, after the first one was kind of like the toughest one to figure out how to do, and you know, to get everything kind of straight without deforming it and tight without any wrinkles. So, you know, this one took the most time, but they really did get easier after this. So there, I basically got all sides to stretch with just a couple staples in, just in case I should have to pull them out later. And once I knew it was, you know, good and in the position I wanted, I just went back with the stapler and, you know, filled in all the areas between them with a couple more staples. And I must say, this pneumatic stapler really makes jobs like this, or, you know, jobs like upholstery where you have to put a lot of staples in, real easy, because those old Arrow T50 type guns really can be, you know, after you get a couple staples in, they're tough to squeeze, and sometimes they'll make things slip too when you're, you know, trying to squeeze them. So there we are. I just went back and now I'm trying to pull the corners, the excess material out of the corners, just putting a staple in near the corners. And then I just did a real rough corner and just pulled the folded the pieces in, you know, half of the corner, and then just pulled it tight. And you know, as you can see, you can see that frame a little bit through it when you get done. But I think next time if I did it again, I would probably put down a first layer of cloth so that you didn't see the frame at all. But we all learned from our experience. Then I just thought I'd go back with a utility knife and, you know, trim the extra fabric, but it turned out that fabric really wasn't that easy to cut with even a sharp utility knife. It, you know, it still gave it a little bit of trouble cutting. Then I got out a pair of these Harbor Freight free scissors that they give out. Tried to do it with that. Turned out they wouldn't cut the material at all in the corners and stuff. So, you know, I tried going back to the utility knife, but I finally gave up. And went upstairs and got my wife's pair of sewing scissors that she has. Now, those are junk, but there they are. They're just, you know, just a little pair of scissors that really cut fabric good. So I borrowed them and was able to just, you know, roughly trim the back of all these frames just to get that extra material out of the way. It takes a while. It's, you know, it's a little time consuming and kind of hard to cut with the exact point of the scissors, but it does work. And like I said before, you really learn a lot from the first one that you do. Well, there's the first one. I just dropped, you know, slipped the frame over it, and everything fit good and came out nice and straight and stretched. So it's amazing how many threads there are in there, how many different stitches, just thousands of stitches in one of these needle points. So after, you know, getting some experience on the first one, went back to do the other five of them, and pretty much wound up doing them all exactly the same, and they each one seemed to go a little bit quicker as you you went along, and the corners started looking a little bit better on some of them. But you know, those corners I still didn't worry that much about because they were all covered under the frame anyway. Yep, so you know, here they are one after the next going together, and you know, in the end I'm real happy with the way the walnut goes with the colors of the threads that she had chosen for all the embroidery. It you know, it did come out like looking pretty good in the end, so I'm glad that I had chosen to use that piece of walnut. So you know, it's funny because it turns out that I got the easy part of the job. It only took me a couple hours to make the frames, where it just took her, you know, weeks to get all these embroidery panels done. So, you know, I got the easy part of it. So pretty much here they are, all done. Everything's framed. Now, originally I was going to just have the frames friction fit over the artwork, but I decided to go back and just put a little bit of hot glue in there for safety, just to kind of help hold everything together a little bit, because some of them did not fit as tight as others. Then we had a spot over the sink where she wanted to hang them all. Now, previously she had made a nice valance that's all embroidered with all her different spices and whatnot, and at the same time she made a couple of dish towels on each side that were embroidered, that I made a couple of brass hangers for there. So she figured, you know, everything would go together, we figured. So, you know, pretty much here they are all hung up where they're going to go. And like I said, in the future there may be a couple more, but we're real happy with the way that they came out and the way that they look, and the way that everything, you know, really goes together now. I just don't know how she has the patience for all this embroidery, because it's just hours and hours of just tiny little stitches one after the next. So, you know, basically there it is, and there's one more towel that she made that we don't know where we're going to put it yet, but, you know, we just have it there for the future use. So I just thought I'd, you know, just kind of share this video of some simple to make frames for, you know, framing something like this, and what I thought was pretty much the easiest way to do it. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe.